My name is Talia. I'm lighting this candle in memory of Jews killed during Kristallnacht.
My name is Richard Kuhl, and I'm a member of the Victoria Shoah Project. Community standing together against hate is the theme chosen for this year's Kristallnacht commemoration, and I'd like to offer a personal story related to this theme. It was the summer of 1966, and I was entering my final year of high school. In the middle of the afternoon, on a hot summer day in August, a tall man carrying a trench coat came into the drugstore at L Street in my hometown of Hull, Massachusetts. I was working at the soda fountain. In those days, drugstores also served soft drinks, ice cream, hamburgers, milkshakes, things like that. And I thought this was pretty strange, a guy with a trench coat on a hot summer day. And when I went over to serve him, he asked for a cup of coffee, another weird thing, because in those days, no one really drank coffee, hot coffee on a hot day. I told him I'd make a fresh pot of coffee, as the coffee on the heater had been there untouched since the morning. As I walked away from him, I noticed as he pulled out a book, it looked like he was reading algebra. With a fresh cup of coffee in my hand, I got closer to the customer's book and I could see it was Arabic and asked him what he was reading. He told me he was reading the medieval Islamic physician Averroes and that he had just completed a 2-year stint in Cairo. He had earned his PhD at Yale and was on his way to the University of California at Berkeley to begin his first teaching job as an assistant professor of Arabic philosophy. He was visiting his friends in my town on the beach. Summer afternoons were always pretty quiet times in the drugstores. Nearly everyone was on the beach a block away, so I had lots of time to talk with this philosopher, to pester him. I was awed and impressed. I had never met someone with a PhD, nor had I met a philosopher. And while I continued to ask him questions and regale him with my philosophical observations, he could only spend so much time with a cup of coffee, and I saw he wanted to return to his friends on the beach. But as he was leaving, I remembered I had just purchased a copy of the Atlantic Monthly, and the cover story was about the free speech movement and the social revolution developing in Berkeley at that time. And it was written by Louis Fuhrer, a philosopher at Berkeley. Thinking that my philosopher friend had been in Egypt for 2 years and he might be interested in knowing what kind of a social climate he was moving into, I offered him my copy of the Atlantic to take with him to the beach. "Why would you lend this to me?" he asked. "You don't know me. I might not bring it back." And I don't really know what I said in reply. It's probably something to do with assuming people are good and honest or whatever. But he took the magazine and he left. He said he'd drop it off later. And so later that evening, near closing time, after the movie theater across the street had closed and we were making ice cream sundaes and banana splits for the crowd, the philosopher walked in, gave me back the magazine, said he had arrived to Logan Airport and had to be off. As I walked home down Nantasket Avenue, I found that he left something in the magazine. In the warm summer air, I pulled out a folded sheet of paper. Written in beautiful Hebrew and Arabic script was a passage from Leviticus and a surah from the Quran. Not having a Quran at home, I could only look up the section from Leviticus, a section that tells perhaps the most powerful moral message, a message that recurs frequently in the Bible. The passage was from Leviticus 19, verses 33 and 34. "Now when there sojourns with you a sojourner in your land, you are not to maltreat him. Like the native born among you, he shall be to you. The sojourner that sojourns with you, be loving to him as one like yourself, for sojourners were you in the land of Egypt." I never knew who the man in the trench coats was, although our previous rabbi, Rabbi Victor Einstein, thought he could be the prophet Elijah coming to the drugstore that afternoon to give me a teaching that would stay with me for my lifetime. Communities stand together against hate. When we remember this important teaching, none of us should be seen as strangers, nor should we see others as strangers. Each of us, each of our communities, has a place in our larger community. "Like the native born among you, shall he and she and they be to you."
My name is Julius Maslovat, and I'm lighting this candle in memory of my parents, Simcha David and Sala Henichowicz of Piotrków, Poland, and for all the people that perished in the Holocaust, both Jews and non-Jews.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Rabbi Lynn Greenoff. Thank you for giving me the honor of being with you this evening. To stand against also means we are standing for. As we commemorate those millions of souls who perished during the Shoah, this night of Kristallnacht, we stand within an ancient framework of rites and rituals of memory, a chesed, a eulogy, given at a burial, Shiva, Shloshim, Yahrzeits, all these rituals give us formalized opportunities to remember a particular soul. Kristallnacht functions differently, out of necessity. We are acknowledging and remembering an ongoing organized mass murder of our people. We're remembering mass loss of life, a loss so incomprehensible and yet so very necessary to remember. Our tradition teaches us also a very hard and necessary aspect of mourning. Mourning must end. We have these prescribed periods of ritual mourning, and then we stop. We stop saying Kaddish for a beloved parent, or a spouse, or God forbid, a child. We know we will hold their memory in our hearts for all our time, but we must bring our formal engagement with these rituals to a halt, even as they've sustained us through our grief. It's an ending that can be very difficult, even as such an ending holds wisdom. But we never forget. Actions are fundamental to our Jewish identity. We act with deliberate purpose, be it in small ways or large. Our mitzvot guide us in these purposeful actions, and we know that symbols and thoughtful learning are an essential component towards undertaking and completing those mitzvot effectively. We must stand with purpose, and in doing so, take a stand for justice informed by that purpose. And that persistent quest for justice necessarily engages us within our communities. Community is fundamental to who we are. A Jew alone? Ideally, we're never alone. As commanded by God, as commanded throughout our ritual life. Tonight, we remember those millions of Jews who died, each alone in their terrible death, and virtually always in the far too many to count company of their people, their communities, whole villages annihilated. And so it has become incumbent for us, for all time, to stand together in community, all of us, Jews and non-Jews, because we are all too aware that decisions made individually impact the larger communities we all live within. And what is hate? What could possibly allow individuals to be led so viscerally into mass murder of people they have virtually no relationship with, other than an ideology so warped that their inherent human revulsion for such acts was erased? Kristallnacht is our annual reminder of the incendiary potential of hatred. Kristallnacht reminds us every year that those buildings, those synagogues, those shops that burned across Germany were what was seen above ground. Underneath that same ground were seams of hatred and fear of those people, those not Christians, that existed and smoldered for centuries and for generations. Hitler was not an anomaly. Tonight we remember. We hold this particular night for our particular place in this world. And tomorrow, we continue to do the work of bringing greater peace and greater justice into this world. We stand for our place in this world as Jews, as Israel, to ensure those underground seams of hatred never burst through the ground again. May the memory of all those who died in the Shoah for Kiddush Hashem be a blessing for us all for all time.
My name is Eric Adelman, and I'm lighting this candle in memory of my grandfather, Max Goldman, who escaped the Ukraine.
My name is Kristen Simmons, and I am an assistant teaching professor in the Department of History at the University of Victoria. The Victoria Shoah Project has invited me to outline what came before the Night of Broken Glass, the appalling nationwide pogrom that swept over Jews in Germany, Austria, and parts of the Czech Republic on November 9th and 10th, 1938. This is the sixth year in a row and the second online that I have been privileged enough to participate in this Kristallnacht commemoration. I have always given my academic credentials in my introduction, but this year I wanted to position myself more personally. The Nazis sent my maternal grandfather, a 17-year-old Ukrainian boy, to be a forced laborer on a farm in Austria during the war. He never saw his family again. My maternal grandmother was an ethnic German growing up in the former Yugoslavia. She fled the advancing Red Army to end up on that same farm. She also never saw her village again. My mother was born in a Flüchtlingslager, a refugee camp for displaced Germans, in 1949. My family's experiences were, of course, nothing like the suffering of the Jews of Europe during the Shoah. I mention them now only to tell you why I became a historian. I wanted to know more about that time. And I did learn more. As a historian of Nazi Germany and the Holocaust, I know more than I ever wanted to about how awful human beings can be to one another. Every year I stand before you and recount the events that are themselves horrific, but which only preceded far worse horrors to come. This year, given our world's current challenges, I want to do something different. I want to highlight those who stood up to the Nazis at each stage, no matter in how small a way. I must stress at the outset, they were exceedingly few. One of the most upsetting outcomes of my research is endless evidence about how ordinary Germans not only passively accepted, but also often enthusiastically supported Hitler's persecution of other Germans. The Jews, as well as disabled Germans, Sinti and Roma Germans, Black Germans, homosexual Germans, and Germans who broke the Nazis' political, social, and racial norms. In the time remaining, I will certainly do what the Victoria Shoah Project entrusted me with, and it is my honor and responsibility to do so. In light of this year's theme of community standing together, however, I will also emphasize Germans who said no to Hitler. Adolf Hitler and the National Socialist German Workers' Party, the Nazis, rose to power in Germany in January 1933. In the midst of the Great Depression, after a series of political, social, and economic crises since their defeat in the First World War 14 years earlier, the German population increasingly turned to Hitler. They expected him to save the country from chaos, from the communists, the hated Treaty of Versailles, and, crucially, those whom many blamed for their current circumstances, the Jews. Not every German did. Even in the final election, after Hitler became chancellor, the Nazis did not receive the majority vote, though it was close. Otto Wels, chairman of the Social Democratic Party, bravely spoke out in Parliament. "In this historical hour," he said, "we pledge ourselves to the principles of humanity and justice and freedom." Wels soon had to flee Germany as the regime launched a wave of terror against its political opponents. But an underground communist group carried on his fight, spreading leaflets that said, "Love your country. Think for yourself. A good German is not afraid to say no." The Nazis immediately began to persecute Jews as well, people who considered themselves to be good, patriotic Germans. The cascade of cruelty was shocking. On April 1st, the regime imposed a boycott on Jewish-owned stores, businesses, and practices. Brown-shirted stormtroopers and Hitler youth stood outside, refusing customers entry. Many ordinary Germans obliged and even openly jeered the humiliated shop owners. Others, though, bypassed the SA and HJ sentries and went shopping. They apologized to Jewish business owners. They brought flowers to their Jewish doctors to express compassion. That they rejected injustices directed at individual Jews was encouraging. Yet it must be said that they almost never openly criticized the Third Reich's newly legalized systemic racism. In September 1935, the Nazi government issued the Nuremberg Laws. These laws forbade marriage between so-called Aryans, ethnically pure Germans, and those considered non-Aryans, Jews, Sinti and Roma, and Black Germans. The laws also changed their relationship to the state. Now they were no longer citizens, but subjects who could be arrested for so-called racial defilement and sent to concentration camps. Jews not wanted here signs appeared at restaurants, swimming pools, and city parks. Most Germans were relieved that a seemingly legal response to the so-called Jewish question had ended the spontaneous violent actions in the streets of earlier years. One, however, expressed outright criticism of the laws. Karl Geordler, mayor of Leipzig, wrote to a friend, "It is our task," he said, "to prevent this misuse of power from causing damage to the German people." In 1944, he would be executed for his part in the plot to kill Hitler. By 1938, with Nazi Germany's annexation of Austria and the Czech Sudetenland, the persecution of Jewish Germans intensified dramatically. They now had to register all assets and property. Access to their own bank accounts was restricted. Their businesses were Aryanized, taken over by non-Jewish Germans. They could no longer practice certain trades, such as traveling sales. Doctors and lawyers lost their licenses, apart from a few still allowed to serve Jewish patients and clients. In August 1938, a law added Sarah and Israel as their middle names. By the autumn, Jews had a large red J stamped on their passports. By this time, those passports had become increasingly useless. As Jews desperately tried to emigrate, few countries were willing to take them. On November 9th, 1938, the Nazis' persecution took more physical forms in the broken glass lining Germany's streets, in the bruised and broken bodies of assaulted Jews, and in the columns of men marched off to concentration camps. A much lesser known aspect of the November pogrom was the extensive damage to Jewish Germans' private residences. No cup was left unbroken, no window left intact, recalled one victim. Another remembered sledgehammers used, quote, to destroy everything. They recalled spilled ink on paintings, rugs, and tablecloths, and that blankets were cut with glass shards. Many dwellings were now uninhabitable. Though such wanton damage and public violence upset many Germans, there were almost no cases of open opposition to Kristallnacht. But some defied the Nazis' intentions in other ways. They denounced assailants, vandals, and thieves to the police, not surprisingly, to no avail. Others assisted Jewish Germans directly by providing food, shelter, and loans of household objects to replace those destroyed or stolen. They warned Jewish neighbors about impending arrests, and even, albeit infrequently, hid them from the Gestapo. Some brave police officers and firefighters protected synagogues and doused their flames against the Nazis' orders to refrain. In this talk, I have highlighted Germans who stood out and stood up in the Third Reich to challenge the Nazis' treatment of Jews. Far, far too many merely stood by. It is easier to turn a deaf ear or a blind eye to discrimination and defamation. Yet we must find courage to challenge the wrongs of our society. We must, as that anti-Nazi leaflet reminds us, not be afraid to say no. Thank you.
I'm Isa Millman, and I am lighting this candle in honor of my aunt Basia's, my mother's twin sister, and also in memory of her baby son Mordechai, who was 2 years old when he was buried alive, as well as in memory of my grandparents and the entire family in Gestapo, as well as my father's family in Stolin. This is a picture of my mother and her twin sister, Basia, taken in Warsaw in 1937.
Shalom. Sometimes I'm asked about the real difference between Yom HaShoah and Kristallnacht commemoration. Yom HaShoah is really, I think, a time for the Jewish family to come together to learn how to deal with the mourning and to look at how we find ways to tell the story of meaning, with meaning about the experience of the Shoah. Whereas Kristallnacht is really about all of us. Kristallnacht is really about the entire city coming together to say, not here. And I think that we're in a time now where so many injustices of our past are coming up, right? Not just in Kamloops, but all around us. And it's not just the colonialists and the indigenous folk, I think it's our whole planet. And really, for us to really talk about reconciliation, we do need to be able to face really difficult truths, but we need to face them together. We can't think that it was only that group that's culpable or that group that's culpable. It's really all of us. And not only is it about being culpable in terms of actions, but I think it's also about the ideologies and the thoughts and the kinds of presence that allowed for these kind of injustices. How much of the vestiges of that past still live within us that we need to be in contact with in order for us to really clear and purge and move into what's ever next in our evolution. I know that this year, unlike other years, I'm not standing with the chief of police and with all of the local clergy and other politicians and leaders. And there's that sense of power, that sense always of standing on the bima and reading together this pledge of support with all of the leaders of my community. There's always a sense of real grounding. And I'm going to read the pledge, but know that I think in spirit, they're all with me. And God willing, in the future, we'll be able to stand together, because it really is about us all standing together against hate, against discrimination, against xenophobia, and moving towards acts of real love and kindness, because I think it's by starting with love and kindness that will lead us to a sense of justice. Pledge of mutual respect and support. Silence in the face of injustice is to agree with the ones who perpetrate injustices. Never will we stand by to allow expressions of racism, xenophobia, or discrimination against any peoples in our community. We will do our utmost to encourage meaningful dialogue and positive action to foster understanding among diverse groups based on mutual respect. And I think, and on top of that, I think as individuals, we have a job to do, which is to really be in touch with our inner self and realize how much of that hate has gotten into our own inner dialogue, and to catch ourselves and to comfort ourselves and to transcend those ideas, because it's really not who we are. And I'm sure it's not who we all want to be. Thank you.
This is my mother, Edith Matus, and this candle has been lit in honor of her uncle, Bernard Weiss, and his wife, Fanny, who jumped out the window to their deaths to escape the Nazis, and to all the other victims of the Holocaust.
Victoria Shoah Project member Joseph Shepherd wrote this beautiful little piece, and I'd like to read it. There's a well-known Stoic saying by the Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius that history always repeats itself, and many find comfort in the idea that all has its seasons. Yet Kristallnacht and the events surrounding the Shoah remind us that we are no longer privileged to allow history to repeat itself. We can no longer allow a repeating societal season of hate, destruction, and targeted aggression. Our Jewish community, like other communities, is enthusiastically diverse. We each have different perspectives and hearts, yet we show profound unity in supporting our cherished community of survivors and their descendants in their keeping of our cultural stories. We are all invited to encounter their presence and hear not only their words, but sense in their prosody and timing an ancestral call for peace and repair. And each year, we gather with distinguished scholars, musicians, youth representatives, and community leaders to preserve our commemorations of Kristallnacht, and each year, this story teaches us anew. Through sharing stories, communities are brought closer in the spirit of collaboration to heal our earth and preserve our homes and families according to each community's ancestral callings and hopes. Kristallnacht teaches us that communities standing together against hate is part of what communities must do each day. May all our ancestors' memories be for a blessing of peace, inclusive of all communities. May history never again repeat itself as it did on Kristallnacht.
Yit Gadal,
Auschwitz,
V'Yit Kadash,
Lodz,
Shmei Rabbah,
Ponar,
Ve'amad Divrachirute,
Babi Yar,
Ve'amlich Malchute,
Maidanek,
V'chayechon uv'yomechon,
Birkenau,
V'chaye d'chol Beit Yisrael,
Kovno,
Ba'gala v'zman Karif,
Yanovska,
V'imru Amen.
Yehe
Shmei Rabbah Mevarach Le'olam V'almei Amaya. Yit Barach V'yishtabach,
Theresienstadt,
Vit Poar Vit Ramam,
Buchenwald,
Vit Nase Vit Hadar,
Treblinka,
Vit Hale Vit Halal,
Vilna,
Shmei de Kutsha,
Bergen-Belsen,
Berich Hu Le'ela,
Mathausen,
Minkol Birchata V'Shirata,
Dhaka,
Tushbechata V'Nechemata,
Minsk,
Damiran V'Alma,
Warsaw,
V'Imru Amen. Yehei Shlomo Rabba Min Shemaya, V'Chaim Aleinu V'Al Kol Yisrael, V'imru Amen.
My name is Misha Menzer, and I'm a member of the Victoria Shoah Project. In June of this year, the world lost a great talent with the passing of Jean Lemon. Jean was a virtuoso violinist and for decades the musical director of Tafel Music Baroque Orchestra. Her gifts were recognized worldwide as she and the orchestra toured. Jean was honored appropriately with numerous accolades, including honorary doctorates and the Order of Canada. For me, however, Jean, more significantly, was a dear friend and a valued member of the Victoria Shoah Project in the few years that she lived in Victoria. She had a direct connection with the Shoah. While her parents fled Amsterdam in 1939 and were saved, many of her family were left behind and suffered through the hardships of the Shoah. Jean never forgot this. She had a strong sense of social justice and equality and brought those values together with her prodigious musical gifts to the Victoria Shoah Project and the community at large. Jean and her life partner, the gifted cellist Christina Mahler, played two moving pieces at last year's Kristallnacht commemoration. Tonight, we remember Jean with love and appreciation and wish to honor her by presenting again their closing piece from the Kristallnacht 2020 commemoration. May her memory be blessed.
This is a folk tune taken from a violin sonata by Antonin Dvorak, and it was for violin and piano, and we've made an arrangement for violin and cello. It's a very haunting folk tune melody that we love.